I'm stuck in another chair.
No, sushi's the best thing.
John is known by many sort of as one of the last prophets of the Old Testament, the Bible. We're going to focus in on him a bit today and some of his story. But I do need some help lighting our Advent candle, if that is okay. Anybody else? Jude? Have you guys done it before?
Yeah.
Yeah, does anybody else want to have a go that hasn't done it before?
Yeah.
Great, come on up.
You don't want to, but that's good. Do you want to do something?
You're not letting the candle,
I think,
for the electric one.
No, it's my name.
So we're nearly there. We're nearly through Advent and to Christmas Day. You know how many days it is? Anybody know how many days it is?
Eight.
Probably should get happy. Right. Let's not have this marriage tip in public. Right, let's say this prayer all together for Advent. Lord Jesus, light of the world, John told the people to prepare for you the very need. As Christmas grows closer day by day, help us to be ready to welcome you now. Amen. Well, we're going to welcome the Lord here this morning in our worship with song. So please, if you're able, do stand or be in a posture of worship as we sing this song and an altogether song where the children will lead us in worship. So, yes, you stand. The cow is coming over. We'll greet one another with a handshake, a hug, a wave, whatever you're most comfortable with. So let us greet one another as members of the family of God. We say together, we are here. We are the family of God. Each of us created in the image of God. So whoever we are and wherever we are on life's journey, we are welcome here. And I invite you to turn to those near you, greeting one another in a way that's comfortable for you. To do so, can I say hello to everybody? As we are coming to see you this morning. Therefore, in the light of Christ, let us confess our sins. Lord Jesus, you came to gather the nations into the peace of your kingdom. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You come in word and sacrament to strengthen us in holiness. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You will come in glory with salvation for your people. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Our hope is in God, who patiently waits for us and diligently watches over us and generously forgives us. Emmanuel, God is with us. Yes, thank you, God, that you are with us, you love us, and you are here to bring us close into your presence. Lord, help us as we stand and sing now to be aware that you are here, your Spirit is with us. Today we long to speak to us. Let us have ears to hear, hearts that are open. Amen. Let's sing together. You don't know this one.
Why is it? I'm
we turn to God's Word, and Max is going to bring it before us this morning, but there are paper copies on the tables. I know you guys don't have a table, but you could steal the ones from the one in front, and grab some pens, do mark up any words that you find memorable, any questions that arise from it, and there'll be 2 minutes to kind of discuss it afterwards, so do listen up and make the most of that time together. So Max, over to you.
There was a man sent from God, his name was John. He came as witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. This is the testimony given by John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" He confessed and did not deny it, but confessed, "I am not the Messiah." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Then they said to him, "Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" He said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah said." Now they had been sent from the Pharisees. They asked him, "Why then are you baptizing if you are neither the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water. Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal." This took place in Bethany, across the Jordan, where John was baptizing.
So do you take a couple of minutes now with people around you to discuss the reading, any striking things that come out of it, any questions that arise? What's it tell you about John and his character? What's it tell you about God and the God that he's proclaiming and the people who are listening? So those kind of questions might be your starting points, but feel free to go off whatever tangent you find necessary. So go for it.
My wording would be everything is known. God knows what there is. I think there is room to think that some of the bad stuff that happens in life is not necessarily God's will. So you know you're in hell. Not forsaken, but deals, situations.
Where do I pray? It's sort of a thing that I take my prayer because what I'm asking is only solutions for them, solutions for them. You know, what is it that I can do to help my teacher? Sometimes it's just about
right, what have we got? What's been coming up in your conversations? Any interesting points? I might pick on David because he had some interesting. Anybody else? Go on, David.
Well, I was thinking that things are so almost structured and planned, where does our free will come into it as well? And clearly I feel that in my life there's been decisions that I've sort of hummed and hard, and I feel I've been nudged in some direction. So it's, I like to think that I've got self-will, but I'm not really sure whether I have, and whether it's submitting to a greater power, being nudged by a greater power, being offered opportunities by a greater power. And here's John, who's actually got total adoration that people want to make him the Messiah, and that he was saying, no, I'm not the one, there's another person. And, you know, he pushed away that, the glory that people were trying to give him as well.
He had a certainty, didn't he? Yeah. Yes, anything else? I know there was because you were talking, so unless there is talking about your roast dinners that you can invite me to later.
We were asking what John got this really world looks like, and
yeah.
How people would have seen him, because he wasn't sort of, we thought like sort of scruffy, and you know, and like, how do you trust somebody like that? He wasn't sort of the stereotype normal person. So we've got how God picked somebody like that to
follow
his plan to go forward.
Yeah, which gives me hope, right? Scruffy, and, yeah. Yeah, but he took a Nazarite vow, people think, so that would have meant a sense of restriction on diet, restriction on clothing, on hair, cutting, all that sort of stuff, so he would have looked a bit disheveled sometimes, and so there's a sense of like, perhaps it added impact to his message as well. He didn't necessarily always have to detract. Yeah. Joe, you want to say something?
I was, but then John told me to be concise. No, I mean, I just mentioned, I think for me, the light thing is that John was somebody who was meant to signpost us to God, and like often in life, I think we look at lots of things that God gave us.
Yeah.
To show us themselves when we get distracted by them, and we sort of look at them as the thing and forget that he was the giver of those things.
Yeah.
To help us to know him better.
Cool. We'll see if that point comes up. Anybody else just before we kick off? Interesting man, isn't he? Interesting text. And so let's dive into it. Let's just explore it together. I've just got like five things that I wanted to explore this morning. I think I've got five. 1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah, fine. Which are very concise. So we're not going to be here for ages, don't worry. But firstly, I want us to notice that John was sent by God. And for us, it's a real encouragement. Not only that he calls those that are scruffy and those that are well kept, those who are on the lowest ranks of societal norms or on the upper echelons of society as well. But it draws us back to the message that we are all created in the image of God. We said it in our piece earlier, to each other. We are all created in the image of God. We are all called here at this time for this purpose. Perhaps we think of Esther, I did, the story of Esther, who come for such a time as this. And Ephesians 2:10 says that, for we are God's own handiwork, his workmanship, recreated in Jesus Christ, that we may do good works which God predestined for us, that we should walk in them. So we're created in his image, made for a time such as this, to do what? Good works. To live lives which reflect him into the world through the things that he commanded us to do. And excuse the male-focused language of this quote, but Dwight Moody was once told, "Moody, the world has yet to see what God will do with a man fully committed to him." Moody went on to become one of the greatest evangelists the world has known. But I wonder what the world would look like if we all were fully committed to him. John, as we've spoken about, took this vow which set him apart for a certain purpose. And I'm not saying we all have to go and eat locusts and never cut our hair again. But whoever we are, the world is waiting for a church, for a people who are fully committed to him. You're not here by accident. You're not here by some chance occurrence, however many years ago, however old you are, plus 9 months. You are chosen, you are valued, you are sent. John the Baptist knew this, and he embraced that sentness. He was certain of what he was there to do. And so I wanted to just say to you, let today be the day you hear of your sentness. You are sent. You are called and you are sent. I made it a word. Sent us. Embrace it. Second point is, know who you are not. John had a specific purpose and a specific style that suited him. His involved a somewhat alternative lifestyle, living under a vow, which dictated his diet, his clothing, and most other aspects of his life. His ministry involved public speaking and physical baptism as a sign of repentance. It involved speaking to those in authority and speaking up against what he considered injustice in Herod's court. That was the shape of his ministry. What shape does yours take? It doesn't have to be the same as John's. Or mine, thank goodness, you'll say. Or Kim's even. But yours. What shape does your ministry take? Know who you are not. What are your strengths? What are you good at? That you can harness for the proclamation, the showing to the world of Jesus. However, what I would say is that this is not an excuse to say no to challenging yourself. Back in the day, I did an internship for a children's and youth ministry, and they created a video that shared the message of Christianity, and they wanted me to share it on my social media, on my Facebook page. At the time, my Facebook was all the rage. I was so nervous. I'd never shared anything to my friends on that thing before. I hated the idea of it, but as soon as I clicked that button and I saw some positive reaction and some apathy or some negative reaction as well, I realised, no, it's not that bad, is it? Often our shape of ministry can be dictated by our comfort levels, or rather our discomfort, what we prefer not to do. You might need to stand up and rock. Perhaps your style of witnessing Jesus in the world isn't public speaking, and that's okay, but there are elements of God's calling to you that you know that you can do, but perhaps you've never been brave enough to try before. So my challenge today is, what shape does your ministry and life take? But what have you been not brave enough to try yet? Actually, you could. Push yourself. So we talked about your sentness, which I've got some funny looks for. Being sent by God. know who you're not, but being brave enough to try and challenge ourselves to grow in our areas. And as Joe mentioned earlier, I wrote down that John used signs, but signs aren't the thing. We have to keep the main thing. Signs point to the real deal. And I would suggest that that's what we also need to be. John got the nickname Baptizer because his ministry involved water, a refresher of ritual cleansing, and a meaningful act, a symbol to the participant of baptism of an internal change or their repentance. But he knew all of this would be surpassed by Jesus himself and the work of the Holy Spirit. And we also can be signs of the kingdom of God. We present Jesus the best we can with our lives, our words, our actions, but ultimately, and here's a breakthrough news for you, you are not Jesus. And the pressure is off a little bit because of that. People's faith journeys are not resting on your shoulders. Paul the Apostle knew this when he writes in 1 Corinthians 13 that he planted the seed, Apollos watered it, but who was it that made it grow? God. God makes it grow. However, we do have something to contribute. We can be signs pointing to Jesus. Our lives of faith can be a shining light to a world in darkness. And we can also offer signs of Jesus in physical ways, like John used water, we can use bread or wine, even gardens, mountains, creation, and more. Signs which, when given context, can help people to grasp something physical, a tool through which they can explore what it is to follow Jesus in their heart. So what can you use? What's in your hands? What's in your toolbox? What signs could you use that are around you? But do you know that you, yourself, are also a walking sign of Jesus? You still with me? You still there? Yes? Great. Fourth one, freely confess. I've already mentioned ways in which we might share our faith through words, deeds, friendships, signs, whatever. But the word I want to focus on here is freely. Freely confess. The task that we're given to confess Jesus shouldn't be under duress. This is what I found to be true in my own life, is as I've become more in awe of Jesus, I've been more compelled to share. The angels are here. The more I'm in awe and wonder, I feel a compulsion to do it, but I do it freely. The difference for me came when I accepted Jesus for myself. I'd grown up in church. I'd known about Jesus all my life. But then I went to university and I explored what it was to not go to church, to live a life free from the conduct that had always been expected of me. But then I felt a tug on my heart to return to Jesus after some time, knowing that my life wasn't hindered by his presence, but actually was enriched by it. And so as I began to love Jesus for myself, not because my parents believed it or that's just what I did, the confession of Jesus and what he means to me to others, and it's commanded of us all if we're followers of him, became easier. It happened freely and joyfully. Not always smoothly, that's different. But joyfully trying, because it came from a place of honesty, of love. That's just a bit of my story when it comes to freely confessing my faith. But what's yours? How might you come to a place where you are freely able to confess faith to others? And I know there's restrictions in certain environments that we go into. I get that. I'm not asking you to get in trouble, necessarily. Perhaps the best place to start in thinking about this, though, is what holds you back? Is it a doubt? Is it a question? Is it just a fear of response? Whatever it is, work from there, and I would love to help you on that journey. What is it that's stopping you from freely confessing, as John did to those around him? And final one, we've nearly made it. Final one. Localized is what I've called this. Localized. You see, mission can be global. Evangelism can go anywhere. I told you the story earlier of me being dead scared to put something out on Facebook, but if you've seen our church Facebook page recently, I've been doing videos to try and explain something of Jesus to those who might watch, and we've had something like 500 views on one of the videos, and that's really exciting that we can go beyond the building and beyond our congregation to reach more people with a message that invites them to explore Jesus. But while evangelism can be global, I would suggest to you that discipleship is always local. It's in a real area with real people. John was in Bethany, doing it in a fairly constricted region. His evangelism and his message was far stretching. John's message and reputation travelled much further than he ever actually did. But his discipleship was local. He had people by his side day and night, guiding them with his words. Jesus did the same. A community of apprentices learning from their master. A community which didn't dissolve at the first sign of disagreement, didn't jump ship because they didn't get their own way, didn't even quit when food was scarce or shelter was lacking. This was a group committed to their master and to each other while they were learning. How I long for us as a church, and I mean globally here, the Church of England around, but also here locally, to be a community like that. It will look different, of course, from following Jesus around the dusty Middle Eastern roads that he walked on. But the commitment to local discipleship, a community committed to journeying with Jesus, to journeying with each other, come what may, is a transforming experience. It is also an appealing community. Where else can people who are crying out for love and connection in our world today find such a brilliant community? That kind of discipleship would see our faith encouraged and enriched, but above all would speak volumes to the world around us about how Jesus is actually present today, working in his people, sharpening us to be like him, prepared and ready for his coming, to steal our Advent prayer earlier. So there you go, and explore through this passage from John. We are sent by God. I want you to know your sentness. You are here for this time. Know who you are not. Your shape of ministry can each look different, but how wonderful might that be as we fit together as this weird jigsaw puzzle, the local kingdom of God. What signs can we use in our life? What tools do we have in our toolbox? What's holding you back from that free confession of faith? And how can we be a community that journey together with Jesus and each other on that journey of discipleship? We're going to take some time to just perhaps think through anything that struck you, or, you know, think through, please Lord, give me something today, because Ben's words have failed me, whatever it might be. But I put some water out on the tables, because John obviously used water as a sign of the coming kingdom, as a physical thing that people could touch to then help them explore that eternal reality. So perhaps you want to use the water today to whatever purpose you find fit. Let's take a moment to just be thoughtful, prayerful, and to use paper, the water, whatever it is, to respond, to write down anything that's in our hearts, our desires, whatever it is. I think, Dave, are you able to play some music? That'd be great.
Should be able to.
Let's pray together. The response is, Maranatha, O Lord, come. In joyful expectation of his coming to our aid, we pray to Jesus. Come to your church as Lord and Judge. We pray for your people locally, Lord, who love you, who desire to follow you with courage, Lord. We pray for those followers of Jesus around the world in your church who are persecuted for their faith. Those who find themselves in prison this day, who are oppressed in any other way. We pray for those who don't feel good enough, who feel too scruffy, too cast out, to even consider that there might be a love for them. A love from you. Lord, we pray you're drawn to yourself. They may know that they are loved and known. And help us to live in the light of your coming. And give us a longing for your kingdom. Maranatha, O Lord, come. Come to your world as King of the nations. We pray for the nations at war, where there is ruin. We pray for those without ability to contact loved ones. Who had to flee their homes. Who even this morning find themselves in a bombed out basement apartment with one gas ring to cook everything on. We pray for those who suffer because of the greed of the nations, Lord, who today won't have food while there are nations that waste so much. Turn the hearts of those in government and those in authority, as before you, rulers will stand in silence. Maranatha, O Lord, come to the suffering, a saviour and comforter. We pray for those known to us who are struggling this day. Break into our lives where we struggle with sickness and distress and set us free to serve you forever. Maranatha, O Lord, come to the suffering as Saviour within the world. Almighty God, as your kingdom dawns, turn us from the darkness of sin to the light of holiness, that we may be ready to meet you in our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ, this Christmas. Maranatha, O Lord, so whatever language is closest to our hearts, let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We're going to continue to respond, or at least invite you to continue to respond as we sing together now. I believe there's a carol involved in this section, so we can get into the festive spirit. Two carols, look at that. Be generous this morning. So let's stand and worship the very Lord, or be in a posture of worship together. favourite part of the service. Notices, yay! So tonight we have our nine lesson and carol service at the church, led by our choir. We have a guest witness, because Moira is still off her feet, bless her, but she'll be there singing along, which is great. So 6:30 this evening, followed by mulled wine and mince pies. So please do come along. Non-alcoholic versions are available, if that is your preference. And then on Tuesday we have cakes and carols, which is slightly more contemporary, I suppose, carol service, with some videos and poems and a band, but also our community choir leading us into songs as well. And they have been sounding in fine voice over the last couple of weeks. So please do invite your friends to both of those services this week. And obviously next Sunday is Christmas Eve. And we don't have any morning services on Christmas Eve. You're invited to go for Holy Communion over at St. Peter's in Odeby. But then we'll be having our crib service in St. Cuthbert's Church, not in the primary school, in the church next Sunday, at 2 o'clock, Burton Overy, 4:30, and then there's midnight mass at past 11. And then, of course, Christmas Day, 10:30 at St. Cuthbert's, 9 a.m. at Burton Overy. But I'll put that all in an email, and it's all on the website as well. But basically, tonight, 6:30, if you want to come and sing some carols, nine lessons, and then on Tuesday, cakes and carols. I think that's all the notices. I hope. Let's have our final blessing, our dismissal, and then we can have coffee, tea, if there's any breakfast, but there's definitely biscuits unopened. Some Christmas biscuits, in fact. We can have some time of fellowship together. So, O Lord our God, make us watchful and keep you faithful as you await the coming of his Son, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. And as we await our coming Saviour, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. Go in peace to eat Christmas biscuits.